Ben karı yüzüyüm ben. Bir de şöyle sonuza kadar isteyeyim. Ben böyle okudum. I like to participate to conferences, to symposiums. It's a good opportunity to learn, to meet people, to share ideas. What I found as a trend in many of these events is that there is a tendency to use a certain set of buzzwords, if you will, things that appear again and again and again. Listings. So I actually heard William mention a few of them, Amin mention a few of them, Marcos. Internet of things. A whole presentation about them. So I was to one of these conferences, and the main speaker was the president of IBM Canada by name of Dino Trentino. He had a very interesting and thought-provoking presentation. And at one point he mentioned something that kind of caught my attention. Of course, he used all these buzzwords. And at one point he mentioned something about blockchain. Blockchain is the new internet. I don't exactly remember how he put it, so that's why I say loosely about paraphrasing. But that was the idea, and that kind of started the thought process in my mind. His focus was on how the two of them revolutionized already the way we live, by the way it touched everything in our lives, and the other one has the potential to do the exact same. But my focus is really kind of a different analogy between the two. So that's the theme of our presentation. Blockchain is the new internet. Let's have a quick look first on the internet. By the end of the 60s, under DARPA's leadership, there were all kinds of projects to try to connect local networks between them. And at one point in October 69, they already had participants. It was huge for them at the time. And by the end of 71, things started to go. They ended up with 15 of them. Don't count yourself as one of 15. So one can imagine how the first experiments went down. No, it wasn't like this. They didn't have the lowercase at the time. It was written their series of series. Of course, to make the internet work, I have a way to switch packets, stuff like that. They ended up inventing the IP address. The IP address seemed like a very good idea, meaning that it provided us with identifiers, numeric identifiers. There was a lot of experience with numeric identifiers from the telephone industry. And by using 32 bits, they had the convenience of having a way to express it in a format that the computer of the time understood. They found a format that we can read. And 4.3 billion combinations seemed to last forever. But it didn't. Computers became cheaper, telecommunication became cheaper, more and more participants came into this internet game. And after a while, we discovered that 4.3 billion are not that many after all. Some of them actually deserve it, not use them, all kinds of things. So what I did, I started to work to find alternative solutions. One of them was the dynamic IP. Dynamic IP, pretty simple idea. It's some sort of a timesharing, except that instead of timesharing the cottage, I'm timesharing the IP address. Meaning that when I'm not using it, it's available for somebody else, which we acknowledge at the time in the prices of the time for telecommunication. It was an excellent idea, because when I was sleeping in my time zone, my computer was awesome, I know still could use the dynamic IP address. And that worked for a while. However, Moore's law. Technology evolved faster and faster. We had now, network printers, we had all kind of other network devices, but more computers, laptops, portables, yeah. What do we do? We don't have enough IP addresses. So they came with that network address translation. So you have one local network, and you have another local network. They both use addresses in the same pool, and they don't interfere with each other. And they present to the internet a certain distinct IP address. And then they manage internally how they do that. However, even that proved to be insufficient after we started with tablets, smartphones, Internet of Things, thank you, Marcus, eating lots and lots of IPs. So they had to practically rethink the whole way of naming these devices. So they came up with IP version 6, IPv6. There is a moral to this story. Internet was an instant revolution and increased popularity, the number of users and users increased. Until it threatened to absorb all the available units of the typical users. And this is what prompted them to build IPv6. Now, blockchain. There is an analogy with what blockchain does. And I will stop a moment to explain how the blockchain works. So, you want to have records with some information. Have space for them, populate with whatever the information is. And then you chain with another piece of information, and the pointer goes to that piece. And you can have a long chain. This is why I have the chain part of the blockchain. But in order to ensure that the information that was stored there doesn't change without authorization, everything is something that we can trust, what they do, they include some hashes. And this hash, this value here, is computed based on everything in the history plus the local, or the last record plus the local record. In this way, locking the record in place. Why is this very interesting? Because this allows us to trust that the content that we're reading there is the right content, wasn't tampered with. And this trust element is very important, and actually Mr. Trevisani was referring to this trust element, because of course, we all know about Bitcoin as one of the applications. This is not the only possible application. You can have, I don't know, something like contracts. Contracts that are locked. Nobody can say, this is not the contract, if the hash is matching. But here's the thing. Let's look a moment to how hashing works. So, you have mathematical function. It takes an input and it generates an output. Let's try mathematical function. And there are some properties here. The input can be of any length. The output is of fixed length. Huge, but fixed length. Knowing the output and knowing the function, someone is not able to guess the input. Also, this mechanism should be robust against some sort of dictionary attacks. Some unique output, and this will avoid what is called collusion. It will be two inputs generating the same output. And all is nice and dandy as long as this works. And it works for now. But if indeed the blockchain is becoming more popular, then there will be more and more applications, users, uses for it. That means that there will be more and more input values that have to generate output values. Now, the set of input values is infinite. From one character to whatever. The set of output values is large but is finite. So at one point we will hit a ceiling. We will end up with collusions and we will not be able to ensure all the properties that so nicely translate in trust. This is what I see analogy. Here it was losing the critical resource, the IP addresses. Here we'll be losing another critical resource, the outputs from the hash function. So, the moral of the story. And I formatted so that they look nice. So what do we do about it? Well, in the case of internet, they started to look at something else, like NFTPs, like NACs, and then ended up with IPv6, which seems for now to be fine. Here what we can do is to use more than one hashing algorithm and store somewhere one hashing algorithm was used. And at least will give us a lifeline for a while. Is it enough? I don't know. So I'm ending by letting you think about it. Maybe somebody will find a solution. I don't know the answer. And by the time we hit this issue, hopefully there will be something.